I'm delighted to welcome you to the Center on Philanthropy and Public Policy's inaugural forum on family philanthropy. Donors and their families, enduring issues, emerging themes, endless possibilities. We are delighted to have JP Morgan Philanthropy Center as our partner in today's forum. The forum is the latest manifestation of the evolution of the center's work focused on donors and their families. The work began about 7 years ago with a group of philanthropically minded women who wanted to be more intentional in their giving. They were interested in making their giving more meaningful to themselves and their families and impactful for the communities and issues that they cared about. In that process, we learned quite a bit, and that has helped to inform and shape today's forum, and we're excited to share it all with you. There are sort of two facts or factors that underpin the center's work to inform and inspire donors. The first is simply based on the principle of the joy of giving. Individuals who feel good about their giving will give more, and people feel good about their giving when it is meaningful to them and makes a difference for the things that they care about personally. The second fact is that there is an amazing opportunity to help shape philanthropy of the future. As philanthropy grows, there is an opportunity to invent it for the 21st century. Just a couple of facts. One, if you look at California foundations, 36% of all foundations in the state have been created since 2000. 36%. Those foundations hold 23% of all foundation assets in the state and account for a third of all giving. That's in the last 15 years. And if you go back to 1990, then the foundations created since 1990, the last 25 years essentially, represent 72% of all foundations. They hold 42% of all assets and account for 54% of all foundation giving in the state. So what we understand is as people move into philanthropy, they have an opportunity to shape it and have an impact on the future. And so we think it's really important to help educate the donors of today and tomorrow. Today's agenda won't exhaust all of the topics that shape family philanthropy today, but we hope the program provides the opportunity to address some of the most salient concerns on the minds of donors today. Philanthropy is a journey. The conversations throughout the day will be relevant and of interest to folks wherever they are in their own journey. As our good friends Joel Fleischman and Tom Turney say in their book, Give Smart, excellence is self-imposed. So to achieve excellence, there is a premium for continuous learning, and that's exactly what we hope happens today. Feel free to ask lots of questions, to share your experiences, and raise your concerns and challenges about how to do your philanthropy. And I hope you will also share with those in the room in the various conversations, not only your successes, but your disappointments, or to be more blunt, your failures, so that others can benefit from your experiences. As I like to often think of it, is what do you wish you knew now that, what do you wish you knew back then that you know now? And so I think that's always a good question to be thinking about. We have people, like I said, at different points in their journey, so there's a lot of opportunity for learning across people at different points in their philanthropic journeys. So I'm excited about it today. I hope you are too. I want to just sort of add a couple of thank yous. I've already recognized our partner in this endeavor, JP Morgan Philanthropy Center, but we have been working with JP Morgan in various ways since really the founding of the center. So especially the LA folks on the private wealth side, as well as the foundation and community affairs side, have been strong partners and have encouraged the work of the center. I also want to thank our two sponsors for today that have been involved with the center pretty much since the beginning, the California Community Foundations and John Kabar and his team, and the Jewish Community Foundation of Los Angeles, Marv Schottlin and his team. I also want to thank, there are a number of people in the room that have served on the board of advisors of the center, that have been philanthropic partners, and much more recently, our new director's circle that has sort of informed and inspired our work in this way. So I want to thank y'all as well. So a big round of applause for everybody. I'm looking forward to today. I hope you are. And I want to start the day by bringing up our first panel. Bob Graziano is going to engage Jeff and Tricia Raikes in a conversation about their philanthropic journey.
I just wanted to thank Jeff and Tricia for coming down today. I mean, we probably spent 45 minutes on the phone the other day just talking about what we were going to talk about, and we concluded at the end of that conversation that we needed about 8 hours to talk about everything that Jeff and Tricia are doing, and we didn't even talk about baseball, the Dodgers and the Mariners, or Stanford, USC. So we could have spoken for a lot longer, but I won't go into a long introduction of Jeff and Tricia. I think their bios are in the program, and I would also encourage all of you to go to the Raikes Foundation website to see some of the stuff that initiatives that they're working on. It's focused on youth, homelessness issues, education, and expanded learning opportunities, and they've done a tremendous amount in a relatively short period of time that they've created the foundation and been running the foundation. So I'm going to really just facilitate this discussion. We're going to have an exercise in between kind of the general conversation and Q&A. So be thinking of questions that you have for them. And again, as Jim said, you could either do that by using the microphone or by writing the question down if you're more comfortable doing so. But why don't we start off, you guys had unbelievably successful careers in the private sector with Microsoft. How did you make the transition from kind of the private sector to working in the nonprofit world, and some of the skills that you guys had acquired in the private sector, how did you translate those into the nonprofit world?
Great. Go ahead. Good.
Okay. Well, first of all, I think it part of the transition is driven by the values that were set when we were growing up. Tricia grew up in Seattle. She'll tell you more about that. I grew up on a family farm in between Lincoln and Omaha, Nebraska. I spent time driving a tractor. Those were the good days. I spent time scooping hog manure.
Those were bad days.
Those were not so good. But at the end of the day, I was very lucky. I would really point to two or three things. One is family, in particular my parents, the context in which I grew up. And then also, throughout our careers, the people that we had a chance to meet and get influenced by. So growing up on a farm near a small community, you get this sense of importance of the value of community. And my parents were very much leaders in the community, so they set a tone. I remember when I was about 12 years old, there was a blizzard. A couple got stuck in a snowdrift near our farm. My dad was quick to offer to help them, and then quick to volunteer me. It was 10 below zero.
Wow.
And we got them out of the snowdrift, and I still remember this image quite vividly. My dad, you know, said, I don't want to take any money from you. I just want to know that if my kids are ever in trouble in the future, somebody will step up and help them. And that is the tone that my parents set. Midway in our Microsoft experience, we met Warren Buffett. Warren said, you want your kids to have enough to do anything, but not so much to do nothing.
Right.
And that was a shaping principle for Tricia and I. How do we take that in? And so we met amazing people. Obviously, we spent a huge amount of time with Bill and Melinda. They've been very influential. Warren was influential. And Tricia, how about you share your
experience? Sure. So I grew up a few thousand miles away from Jeff in Seattle. Came from a modest middle-class family. And I think when I look back, what we didn't have in financial means, we made up for it in the way we engage with community. My mother was a chronic volunteer. And I tell you, any organization came along, United Way, Heart Association, March of Dimes, she was always the first to volunteer to be the block captain or the neighborhood captain. And back in those days, you basically walked the streets and knocked on doors. And I was the little person next to her holding the white donor envelopes. And so I sort of learned at my mother's side. When we weren't doing that, I was sitting next to her at the sewing machine making bean bags or stuffed animals for children, the children up at Children's Hospital. Or we were cooking in the kitchen and delivering to local shelters. So I think early on, it was sort of clear that the strong value in my family was the importance of engaging in community and doing what you can, whether it's financial or whether it's your time and talent to give back. And so I think from an early point in my life, my mother was really my first role model, really teaching me that people are always at the center, always need to be at the center of the work. Dialing forward, as Jeff mentioned, we both joined Microsoft in 81. I preceded Jeff by about 6 months, and it was an exciting time in a young industry. And it was, we spent some pretty crazy hours there, but I still had a hankering for re-engaging in community. And lucky me, Bill's mother, Mary Gates, was one of the most prominent females in philanthropy at that time. And she delighted in helping the young female leaders at Microsoft figure out how to engage in community. So she was really the one who helped me connect with my first board position. And so I think that was sort of early in our journey. And of course, Jeff and I happened to be at Microsoft at just about the right time when the company went public. And so though we were found ourselves to be sort of first generation philanthropists, I think we took that role quite seriously. And we're really committed to being sort of serious stewards about a portion of society's wealth. And to figure out how to return that in a responsible way led us to really start our foundation.
That's great. Talk a little bit about your children and how you see them, how, continuing the value system that your parents created for you, et cetera, and also maybe a little bit about how that shaped kind of your mission and your pillars for your organization and kind of how you've gotten them involved and do you see this continuing for many generations?
Well, I'm sure as many of you agree, there's nothing like being parents to be to sort of to be both humbled and to sort of learn some good lessons. And I think for us, there's probably a bit of a perfect storm. I think at the time we had a very young foundation structure. Life was pretty crazy at Microsoft, and our kids were in the elementary and middle school years. And our eldest was having a heck of a time with bullying in middle school. And I think we were pretty confounded with trying to figure out how we could mitigate that and kind of what was going on. And I think in the process of researching bullying, we discovered lots of smart people were focused in that area and there were a lot of good programs. So as we continued sort of diving a little bit deeper into the issues of, you know, what goes on in middle school? Why are those years so difficult for our young kids? And that really sort of led us to understand more about brain development and that sort of critical developmental time that happens in middle school. So it was very much of an iterative process, but absolutely grounded in the experience that we were having as parents. And so that's just sort of one example of sort of the evolution of at least one of our strategies. Our work eventually led us to a researcher at Stanford named Carol Dweck, who was very early in her exploration of growth mindset, helping young people develop the self-efficacy, the sense of their own capacity. And I think that work eventually led into what is now our educational strategy. So that's just an example of, again, it was rooted in our personal experience as parents, but our curiosity and the iterative process led us to some of the work that we're doing today.
Interesting. Jeff, maybe you can talk for a second to your experiences running the Gates Foundation and some of the takeaways you've learned from the Gates Foundation and how you've applied that to your foundation.
Yeah. Well, you might describe me as an accidental CEO. I went to Bill in late in 2007. I said, I was looking for the next chapter. I wanted to do some new things, and I wondered if he needed a little bit of help at the Gates Foundation on their agricultural development work. I mean, I grew up on a farm. I know a little bit about it. About 5 months later, I'm the CEO. So it wasn't exactly how I had planned things, but I am absolutely grateful to Bill and Melinda for giving me that opportunity. I describe it as my graduate degree in philanthropy. Mm-hmm. And it was not only getting a chance to see how they think about philanthropy, how the Gates Foundation operates, and we're talking about pretty amazing scale here. And that was part of what they wanted from me. The foundation had roughly tripled in just the 3 years before I started. And so, my experience at Microsoft, when Tricia and I started, there were less than 100 employees.
Wow.
$12 million in worldwide annual revenue. So I experienced a lot of growth in my career. When I left Microsoft, there were 92,000 employees, and I was overseeing roughly 17,000-20,000 people. So I had a lot of experience with that. What Bill and Melinda wanted me to do was to really put in place kind of the infrastructure and the discipline around their strategies and that sort of thing. So it was a tremendous symbiotic relationship where I got that chance to contribute, but I learned a lot, not only from the Gates Foundation, but also from the philanthropists that I met around the world. And that was fantastic as well. So there are probably two things I'd highlight, Bob. Yeah. One is that Tricia and I actually were together. She on a trip in Africa. I guess we were way south in Ethiopia. And we were at a primary healthcare clinic, and it just reminded me that it's so easy to get singularly focused on an intervention, like a vertical intervention, like HIV prevention or getting kids vaccinated. And here you are in this community, and they're trying to do those things, but also food and nutrition and water and sanitation and hygiene. And I came back from that trip and created what is now the integrated delivery unit of the Gates Foundation. The point is that I concluded if you want to have long-term sustainable impact, you're going to have to move systems. You're going to have to understand the system in which you're operating and who are the players. And frankly, you got to really be clear. It's not just about you. Mm-hmm. It's really about all of the different actors and entities. And so that was a very important insight that I gained during my time getting my quote-unquote graduate degree in philanthropy. The other one, I started to get really curious about how philanthropy operates. And I concluded that there are different operating models in philanthropy, checkbook philanthropy, venture philanthropy, catalytic philanthropy. As examples. But in particular, I was a little stunned by some research that indicated that while this is a huge period in history of wealth transfer, some of what Jim shared with you this morning underscored that. The research would suggest that of philanthropists or donors, especially surveyed of high net worth donors, while they want to have great impact, 85% said they want to have great impact. Only 32% spend even 2 hours doing the research on the entity that they're going to give to, and only 9% do any form of comparative benchmarking. And that, I want to be clear, I'm not criticizing the donor or the philanthropist. What I'm saying is we have huge potential for impact in society with philanthropy. What can we do collectively to raise our game to reach that impact? We'll probably talk about that more later.
Right,
but that,
right.
Those were two things that came out of my Gates Foundation experience.
Interesting. And Tricia, you and I were talking a little bit earlier about the systems. And I said, when I said to you, how do you know if you've actually had an impact on the systems and a long-term impact, et cetera? And you just said data. And I think that's something that a lot of people a lot of people in the room struggle with in terms of how do you measure the impact? How do you get the data to make sure that you're having a systematic change so that it's not just a Band-Aid that's going to fall off in a short period of time? So I'm curious as to how you're doing that today with a relatively limited staff of people that are working with you, et cetera. How do you get all that data and analyze it appropriately?
Bob was really surprised. Computer people want data?
I'm a recovering accountant, so I love data.
Well, it's probably easiest to sort of use an example. We just went through the infamous strategy review period. I don't know if others do that at their foundation, but I think it always sort of, brings fear into the hearts of our employees. No, anyway, so once a year we kind of go through an annual review process. And I think, we're getting smarter about how to have sort of a systems lens. And I think when you can get closer to really defining sort of the problem and understanding sort of the data set. For instance, in our youth homelessness work, the systems have gotten to the point where we have a pretty accurate sense of the inflow, the number of kids that come into the system on an annual basis. We have a sense of, with the housing stock that we have, how many kids we can accommodate on a monthly basis, and then what the delta is. And that helps us then be a lot crisper about where we focus our collective efforts as a community. So we know that if the delta is 75, then we know that we've got a number of different strategies that we can deploy. We can add more housing options and look at the various housing stock that we have, because you've got shelters, permanent housing, and some new innovations that we're doing in the host homes area. But you can also look at diversion strategies. How do we actually keep those kids out of homelessness and help many of them potentially reconnect with families? So again, that's an example of how mm-hmm. data has helped us in some of our strategies, when we can get really clear on what are the key pieces of data that we need. How do we collect it, and then how do we analyze it, and how does it drive us forward with our work and our priorities?
Yeah, and I asked that question somewhat from a selfish perspective, because I'm on the board of the LA84 Foundation, which is the Olympic, mm-hmm. surplus from the Olympics, and we've given away hundreds of millions of dollars over the last 30 years, and the question becomes, yeah, a lot of kids have had access to sport, but what does that mean? I mean, has it helped mm-hmm. them in terms of graduation rates, et cetera, and we're struggling with that as an organization. So, I mean, I'm sorry, Jeff, you were going to say something.
Yeah, I was just going to add to what Tricia said, just to give you a few of the nuggets we got from the most recent strategy review on youth and young adult homelessness. And just to clarify, what we're talking about here is the 12 to 24-year-olds who are out on the street by themselves. And that was an under-resourced area because the visibility is chronic homelessness and veterans homelessness and family homelessness, and those segments are all very important. But you have to understand they are segments, they have different operating models, there's some sharing of resources across them. But for these youth, what Trish and I learned is that the systemic work we're doing in Seattle, we've gotten the shelter stay, the average shelter stay, down from 116 days to 76 days. We've gotten the what I'll call recidivism. In other words, youth who exit the system and get into permanent housing, 20%, the baseline was 20% would within 2 years be homeless. That's now down to 3%. So that gives you how we get in. It's messy, but we get in at the systems level and try and really understand what's the underlying systems infrastructure, the data within that, who are the actors, and we try and figure out where we can move the needle. Because money alone is not going to solve this stuff. What you have to do is you got to figure out how to get more out of the resource available, and where you do think you need more resource, you need to really understand how it's going to be used. So that's an example of how we would use data.
Yeah, and one of the things that you guys are doing and continuing to do is helping other donors, trying to figure out how to how to do this. Talk a little bit about that in terms of what you're doing. I mean, because all of us, I mean, one of the great things about the Center for Philanthropy, et cetera, is trying to bring people together to help each other. How are you doing that with the Raikes Foundation?
Maybe, well, why don't you, I think the youth collaborative, the youth homelessness collaborative that you've led, I think is, you know, the funders group, I think is a great example.
Right. So I'll probably step back and just sure. tell you how we got involved in the area of youth homelessness first. Back in 2006, 2007, Jeff and I had the honor of chairing the United Way of King County campaign. And during that period of time, we were exposed to the issues of chronic adult homelessness because that was a new initiative for our United Way. And so we had that baseline of knowledge around homelessness. And a number of years later, I had a very unexpected, powerful experience with a young a girl who was homeless because she looked just like our daughter and her girlfriends who were in high school at the time. And it was such a stunning visual for me to see this young woman in the midst of this sort of adult homelessness setting that it was really, it really brought up a lot of emotion for me. And so we came back and that really kind of launched our foundation's effort to really understand this population around youth and young adults. And we did a local scan, we did a national scan to find out who was doing what in that sector, and really came to find out that there was very little known about youth and young, unaccompanied youth and young adults. The sectors that were already well established were veterans homelessness and family homelessness and chronic adult homelessness. But very little was understood or was being done, certainly systemically, around youth and young adults. We certainly found some great programs and services that were being offered, but that was only when young people sort of arrived at that door and were in crisis. So that started our journey, and what we did was to invite some of our private foundation colleagues and some of our public partners to a presentation so we could share with them what our findings were in our region and to measure their appetite for engaging with us on the issue. And so that started our journey. I can remember back then some of our private partners grumbled a bit about the fact that we'd invited our public colleagues into the room because they said, we just don't play very well together. And I think that was some of our early push, knowing that at some point, if you really want to scale, you have to have a sort of public ownership of the system. And so as it turned out, it played out well for us because as we ventured into this work, certainly the private sector were the early investors because we had to innovate. We had to create some of those system infrastructures that didn't exist. We really had to bet on trying some prevention programs that didn't exist. And so the private investment early on was about $3 million. And that came out of a funders group that I, 5 years later, I'm still co-chairing. And it has a broad array of funding partners in the community, both private and public, that come together about four times a year to really identify where the priorities are, what we know, you know, where we're going to be pivoting. And it's really been an extraordinary process, but it took time to build the trust, to really understand how we were going to work together, and for private funders to really lead with some of that that initial infusion of capital. And it's paid really good dividends in terms of now having public ownership at our county level. Our city's very engaged, and now a lot of the work is beginning to scale to the state. And of course, we have some wonderful national partners as well. But you know, you just can't do it alone. And right. And in fact, I would say that probably the reason why we've been able to move or make the progress that we have made is because of that large collective voice, right. All sort of speaking or being aligned with
Tricia,
our point
of
view.
I'm curious because, as you guys know, So we talked about this a little bit. Los Angeles is, you know, getting serious about addressing the homelessness issue. There was a initiative on Tuesday's ballot to increase the sales tax to provide public housing, and I know we talked a little bit about, or provide housing. I know we talked a little bit about, you know, the effectiveness of that. Is there a collaboration between what you're doing in Seattle and what's going on in Los Angeles, and lessons learned from some of the stuff that you've done there? And I know Elise Buick from the United Way is supposed to be here today. I don't think she's here yet. But are we learning from each other? Are you guys, I mean, because you guys have kind of already been out in front of some of these issues. LA's doing it. We've created the public-private partnerships. I mean, we've really been able to accomplish a lot over the last, but we're just kind of at the beginning of this journey because there's still tens of thousands of people on the street. Now we have the funding. We have to make sure we do it properly. I'm just curious.
Well, first of all, congratulations to LA. I know that it sounded like the vote was tight, but, so
vote.
Far so good.
Yep.
Understanding is that that's a sales tax that will really help provide some of the support structure around the bond that was passed last fall that was focused on housing. So congratulations, because it really is, you need both parts.
Right.
You know, not only the housing, but also the support structure that around that housing to really help individuals, whether it's mental health services, employment, skill development, et cetera, to really to sustain their independence.
Right.
So that's exciting. So a couple things. One is, again, our area of expertise is in the area of unaccompanied youth, and I know that we have worked with our colleagues in LA. In fact, we were funders on an initiative last year called the 100-Day Challenge, an organization called Rapid Results Institute, has this approach where they come into a community, and last year it was LA, Cleveland, and Austin, and we were funders because it was a really important learning opportunity for us and something that we are now going to be moving to our state in the next year or so. But the idea is that you bring together all of the critical actors in the system, and they collectively come up with a single goal. And in this case, I know LA decided that in 100 days they were going to house 237 youth, I think was their number. And I think that the design of the approach is to really both unify the actors, have a common goal, and then the sense of urgency around a very short timeline, which really makes people prioritize how they focus their resources. And that's been a really great learning, because LA beat their numbers. I think they housed at least 240 young people.
Mm-hmm.
Working along with Cleveland and Austin, the effort is really beginning to surface some practices that are common and that are effective sort of across geographies. And so I think that's really been helpful. And I know that with other sectors like the adult homelessness or family homelessness, again, in our region, we are really lucky to have like-minded colleagues.
Mm-hmm.
The Gates Foundation is very involved in family homelessness, and they very much take a systems approach. And though we communicate with each other and we share in each other's learnings, we also are quite keen to be aware that there are some unique needs for our population. So where rapid rehousing is particularly effective with the family homelessness sector, in a 3 to 6 month time frame, you want to transition families sort of into and through that system. For youth, we're finding it's a longer timeline, just because of where they are developmentally. So again, we are all working to get much better with our systems work and to stand up the systems that the pieces of the systems that are working. But we are also careful to understand that we need to really be clear on what works for our populations too.
Couple more questions, and then we'll do the exercise and then take questions from the from our group here. Jeff, talk a little bit about, because it's an issue that everybody here grapples with, in terms of a foundation that's designed to be in perpetuity versus a foundation that, you mean, you've worked for the Gates Foundation. I think you and Tricia have talked about Plan 2038, which is sunsetting, but 2038. So talk about your thoughts about creating a foundation that's going to be well into the future versus one that has a larger impact in a shorter period of time.
Yeah, the one of the discussion of a perpetual foundation versus a non-perpetual foundation. But I don't like the marketing of that, because perpetual, that sounds good. And non-perpetual, that sounds bad. Yeah. So I now am going to reposition these things where perpetual, really what that means is limited payout. And non-perpetual, what that really means is giving in time. The bit of a pet peeve here, for whatever reason, when the genre of private foundations began to get set up 100 years ago, it almost became the default. Well, in fact, it really did become the default that they were perpetual foundations. And I think that's not right. It's not that I don't think that people should choose perpetual foundation. I just think it should be thought about. So that'd be my first point, is it's a very important consideration. When we set up our foundation in 2002, we were just like everybody else. You know, hadn't really thought about it. The default was perpetual. We were perpetual. And then we started to learn about how Bill and Melinda thought about it, how Warren thought about it. Warren Buffett is in particular more giving in time. And so that got us to consider. So now let me make it personal. For Tricia and I, as part of how we feel that we were raising our kids and then supporting their launch in life, we just think it's really important that they find their own path in life. It may at some point in time come back, come to philanthropy, but we do not want to impose that on them. We want them to find their path in life. They're all in their 20s. In addition, there are some other principles that I think we've learned through our experience with philanthropists. One of the things that I think is great about people like Bill and Melinda, active donor philanthropists, they're the wealth creators. And they have a certain spirit of a sense of urgency and willingness to take risk. And one of the things that I see in perpetual foundations that have been around for a number of generations is that you get into the third generation and beyond, and I think it gets challenging because the foundation ends up in the hands of trustees who, under governance, almost by definition, have to protect the reputation of the institution. And then I think that means they're going to be less likely to take risk. And I also think the mentality that we're trying to perpetuate this thing causes people to say, we're perpetuating this thing. It's kind of about us, our identity. I think it reduces some of the collaborative nature that we think is important. Now, many people will say the reason to sunset is because you get out into the third generation and that the people who are leading the foundation, maybe it's grandchildren or great-grandchildren or others, they may not represent my intent.
Right.
And I think that's an important issue, too. That actually is not the thing that drove our decision.
Mm-hmm.
Our decision to be giving in time was our belief that we want our kids to find their own path in life. We don't want to impose our philanthropy on them. That we have a view of net present value. I think our J.P. Morgan colleagues will appreciate that. And there's sort of the net present value of putting our wealth into society now and getting this impact now. And the other thing is we find a lot of pleasure, joy in the work. And there are other attributes that cause me to want to encourage people to think carefully about the decision. But my number one thing is don't treat it as a default. It should be a very conscious decision that each and every one of you make about what you want the construct to be. And I do hope that in aggregate, in the macro picture, more and more philanthropists choose to go giving in time. The 2038 reference is that we have targeted 2038 as the quote unquote completion of our wealth back.
And how did you come up with 2038? What was
because we're going to be really old.
Yeah, we'll. You know, I think we've seen folks. We were chatting about Charlie Munger, yep. who's a friend yep. and Costco board member. You know, you see some people who are just amazing at age 93,
yep.
and you see some at 78 who are maybe not yeah. so amazing.
Yeah.
And so it was not a random choice, but 80 seemed like a good sort of time to yep. not be leading the foundation work.
Got so. It. Just one more general question before we go to the exercises. What other advice would you give philanthropists that are just starting or in the midst of trying to, stuff that you've learned?
Yeah.
You know, Jim said at the beginning, failures that you've had, that you've learned from, anything that you could share with the group in terms of your learnings over the last several years and maybe some things that you could impart to them?
You know, I would, the first thing that comes to mind, I think, you know, philanthropy is really personal. And so I think that connection to heart is very real. And I think when you are passionate about an issue, I think it will drive drive excellence, because I think it will, it's messy stuff. And I think that passion will help, you know, move you through some of those periods where you feel like you've lost ground. You've had some setbacks, and so I think I would definitely say that heart is definitely important to have at the root. I've had a number of people say to us, you're so lucky that you found things that you're working on that you're passionate about, and you know, that they're looking for those things as well. And I have to say, it's not that clean or neat. You know, if I remember the story about bullying. It was really out of sort of frustration that sort of led us on that path, and it was very iterative to get to where we are today. Or with the issue of homelessness, youth homelessness, that was not something that that sort of struck us as you know, with doing some research to do. It came out of outrage around something that absolutely. Was unacceptable from our perspective. And so it very much is an iterative process. So I'd say the main thing is to jump in and to be curious and to look into issues and see where it takes you. Because I think that that's where that may be, very well may be the path to really get you towards some of the issues that you will find that you're very passionate about.
So I'll build on sure. Trisha's point and also lead into some of the research okay. that we've been doing. So for example, you know, we mentioned that there's this challenge of how do we raise philanthropy to be more impact driven. And we worked with some colleagues at Stanford University, the Philanthropy and Civil Society Center folks that I think Jim probably works with as well. There's a terrific Jim's leading a terrific effort here. And one of the things that we got clear about is that we think that one of the most important things that philanthropists can do to be more impact driven is to have a certain set of mindsets and behaviors. Maybe think of it as following a certain set of principles. Mm-hmm. And we connected with the Donor Education Network. This is a group of organizations that work on educating donors, and they had a set of principles. They're like seven or eight. But we reduced them down to what we think are the three most important things. One is, number one, have a clear, sustained focus. You know, as Tricia said, find that thing that draws your passion. And if what you do is you invest in causes that you're passionate about and you stick with them, that provides a basis for you to have lasting impact. So that'd be number one, clear, sustained focus. The next one is research-informed strategy. You heard that in what Tricia said. It was very important for us not to just dive in and just fund youth care, which helps on youth homelessness, but actually to step back, understand the system, understand the landscape, what is the current level of resources, what are the current approaches that people are taking. And we think when you do that, when you understand the capacity of the potential partners, then you're much more likely to be able to have a set of actions along with a set of collaborations that will really move the needle and have lasting impact. The third thing that we would call out is continuous collaboration and learning. You know, we know that we won't move the needle on, say, youth homelessness unless we are working with other donors, whether we have to be working with the people in the system itself who are closest on the ground. They are the heroes, honestly, every day. We have to be working with the public sector leaders. We have to be working with the private sector leaders who have a vested interest in this. And so that notion of continued collaboration and continued learning. There are things that we learn in this strategy review effort that Tricia mentioned. We're doing that every year because we're really trying to set a tone of continuous learning. What's working? What isn't? What should we change? Where should we adjust? So on and so forth. So we would say those three things are really important. Clear, sustained focus, research-informed strategy, continuous collaboration, and learning. And Nadia Rahmani is here with us. Nadia is with the Stanford Philanthropy and Civil Society Center and is also a design school or D-school fellow at Stanford. And she helped us on part of the work, and you're going to become part of our research. So thank you.
Yeah. Actually, Bob, I just want to add one more thing that sort of back to sort of a point I made a little earlier around people-centered. One of the things that has been really important in our work is to make sure that the voices of the people that you intend to serve are very engaged in the work. And I have to say, around the youth homelessness piece, having youth at the table has probably been one of the smartest things we've done. And it was a small grant years ago where we engaged an organization that was working with young people, actually, that had formerly been in the foster care system. And they were teaching the kids how to be advocates for themselves and also to be advocates for their colleagues. With our elected officials. And we talked to them about their willingness to kind of open up the tent and include homeless youth where, you know, there's a fair amount of overlap between those populations. And it has turned out to be one of the best investments. And the young people have been such important colleagues in helping to design a system because they've experienced this. It's been a lived experience for our young people, and we have seen them really help to move legislation in our state too. So that would be the other thing is to really engage, with the audience that you intend to serve, because they will provide wisdom that will be so valuable to the work.
Basically, a 20-year sunset plan for your foundation. Have you begun the planning exercise for how you're going to program the spend down for that 20 years? Obviously, hopefully, investment returns will be really good and it'll stretch it out. You'll be able to spend more money, but have you thought about that?
Yeah, when I went to, so I think we got the microphone in time. The question is, how do you program over a 20, 23 year, I guess 21 year now, time's passing, 21 year period of time. When I went to the chief investment officer in our family office and said I'd like to do a reverse Monte Carlo simulation, I think he kind of thought I was a little crazy. So one aspect of what we have to do is we have to figure out how to manage the overall portfolio, the financial side of it. So that's an exercise that's been underway for a couple of years. Essentially, we have a model and we just keep up of what we think it'll look like over a 23-year period of time, now 21-year period of time, and we just keep updating it based on what we see in terms of market returns, current projections, and our rate of payout. You know, so that's one aspect of what we have to do. But the more important aspect is, how do you go about picking what are those things that we're going to do? And one of the things that
that may surprise you is we didn't take all of the relevant assets and just put them into the private foundation. We have a baseline of what's in the private foundation, but then we have a lot of personal assets that ultimately will be given away. But because they're not in the private foundation, we don't feel any 5% payout pressure. And it's my belief, and I saw this at the Gates Foundation, is that foundations get into a mode of shoveling money out at the door at the end of the year. And what Trish and I have told our team is that we want to pick probably 7 to 10 big bets that we're going to pursue over this 20-year period of time. And we'll be in them for the long term, like the work on education that Tricia referenced, growth mindset, learning mindsets and skills. We'll probably spend in excess of $100 million on that over the next 10-year period of time. That is a big bet. You know, I don't know if we'll have 5 more like that or 7 more like that, but we're trying to look for those kinds of big bets where we can work in a system and improve it in ways that will have lasting impact. So you have these two different things you have to do. One is you have to figure out how you're going to manage the financial resources. And I probably should have mentioned that Trish and I are expecting to live beyond 80. So there is this kind of little safety net we have to have, because I'm thinking 105.
Yeah. Maybe, you know, we have some family history that would lean
so,
in that direction.
So there's some trickiness there, too. We have a couple of investments that are unbelievable wild cards that could, you know, shape things. So you kind of have to do these two things in parallel. I would say that I feel really good right now about how we're thinking through the financial side. And by the way, in part because we want to help others, we've started to work with Harvard Business School on a case study on the investment management side, which we hope then will help inform others as to how to think about the financial management side of things. I'd say Trish and I feel like we've got more work to do on the programmatic side.
Especially given the lead time of, you know, for strategies to sort of fully develop, we're probably behind schedule.
Right. Shirley.
Yes, if I may, I would like to play devil's advocate to Jeff's idea of foundations in perpetuity.
Sure.
Because what I see is that many foundation founders don't realize that the little grandchildren that are running around at ages 3 or 4 may grow up to be quite astonishing philanthropists. And they can inspire that second, third, and fourth generation by bringing them onto junior boards. The other issue is that very often the foundation internally acts as a very cohesive force for the family. As different generations come back for board meetings and talk about the issues in society that they care most about, and they may be philanthropists that actually expand your mission and the meaning of your mission. So I think we need to keep both perpetuity on both sides in mind.
Great. And I'd like to just respond to Shirley's comments, because I think they're very important. I think the key thing I would like people to do is to think about the decision. You know, for some people, the best decision may be perpetuity. For others, it may be giving in time. We've chosen giving in time. It sounds like you've chosen perpetuity. We completely respect that. And you give good reasons why that is the right choice. I think number one point is take the time to make the decision. The second thing is, in our case, Trish and I didn't mention that we actually have a 2063 plan. and this creates some interesting issues in terms of the financial management. But if one of our kids really wants to get involved in philanthropy where they would like to lead it, and we think they have the skills and capability to lead it, then we'll extend it for one more generation. But that's it. I mean, in this case, we've made the decision because we don't know who the grandkids are. In fact, they don't even have boyfriends or girlfriends right now. So, you know, it's difficult for us to make the decision to do in perpetuity when we don't have that. So that's part of what we, that was part of our calculus, if you will, but Shirley makes great points about why you should think about both options.
Thank you. It's interesting, Shirley, too, because we talked about this at dinner last night with Lisa, that, you know, that, you know, the in perpetuity, you know, commitment really requires a lot of governance and structure around it. And you guys have done a great job of that. But, you know, we oftentimes see people who haven't done that, who really haven't given thought. And I think Jeff's right. I mean, we have many, many clients that say we're going to set up a foundation in perpetuity, but don't really plan for that. You guys have done an extraordinary job in that area. But many foundations don't. And so after generation one or generation two, they're really adrift and haven't had the impact, et cetera. So.
Hi, I was interested, I guess, as a business person, to hear about your approach of a strategic review once a year, and I commend you for that. I would assume that working together, you get very close to what you're doing, and that you might want outside voices and outside, and clearly Nadia sounds like someone in the last 2 years who's come to help you, but talk to us a little bit about how you do that review process and how you involve outside, you know, people to give you, to kind of push you and push back and think about new ideas.
Okay, so actually this truly is borrowing from my Microsoft leadership experience. We were very disciplined about, when I led worldwide sales, marketing, and support, we did annual reviews of each of the businesses of 72 subsidiaries. And it was a very disciplined process to say what's working, what isn't. So when I came to the Gates Foundation, I discovered two things that I thought was problematic. But I'll call out two relevant to this, which is, one, there was no mechanism to engage Bill and Melinda in a very predictable fashion on each of the strategy areas. And so I put it in place there in part for that reason. But the other reason is I'm a big believer that you have to have that sense of reviewing what went well in the last year, what didn't, what adjustment do we need to make. Think of it as having a scorecard. And in fact, I did implement a scorecard system so that we could really monitor whether we were on track or off track for what we expected. And so I just think that discipline is really important. We do a survey of our grantees in conjunction with the Center for Effective Philanthropy. That allows us to benchmark how our grantees are thinking about us, as well as how we compare to other grant-making organizations. We also do an annual retreat. We typically do it at our home on Hood Canal. We own the hotel next door. It's called Alderbrook Resort and Spa. Alderbrookresort.com. It's really nice. Condé Nast put it 75th in the U.S. as resorts. I'm just saying. You know, that's an opportunity. And we typically bring in, like, the youth homeless voice group that Tricia mentioned. They've participated. We've had some of the grantees, like Ron Dahl from Berkeley on adolescent brain science, participate. And so we use mechanisms like that. The other thing is, Trish and I do learning trips. We'll do, is it three this year?
Mm-hmm, three.
Yeah, and so those learning trips are an opportunity for us to really get out there and see things. Those are hard. One of the things that, sorry for the long answer, but one of the things that is really difficult in philanthropy, I'm sure you're all aware of it, but I'm going to put a label on it. There are distorted power dynamics. You know, when I came to the Gates Foundation, you know, ultimately I had a budget of $4.5 billion per year. I didn't realize just how funny, good-looking, and smart I was.
And I'm sorry, honey.
Trisha's putting you in your place.
Yeah.
I'll work harder at that.
I know better. I know better. And you just have to understand distorted power dynamics. I never, at the Gates Foundation, went to a grantee and said, how are we doing? What I did is I said, what is the one or two things that we could do differently that would help your work be better? Because you have to break through on these distorted power dynamics. You're going to be told by the grantee just how fantastic you are because you're giving the money. But that's not actually going to help the work get better. And so Tricia and I try and use the learning trips, and it was super hard on learning trips with Bill and Melinda. They're just, it's just by almost by definition, it's hard for them to not be over orchestrated, you know? And so you got to figure out how to be clever enough to break through the orchestration and the distorted power dynamics to get the real story. And I would say the learning trips and informal grantee conversations and informal conversations with beneficiaries is far more important than what we do in the strategy reviews. To your question of dialogue.
Question, the two of you seem so incredibly in sync and aligned on everything. Has there ever been a time or are there times when you have, you know, significant disagreements over direction, mission, et cetera? And how do you, if so, how do you resolve those? I mean, how do the two of you kind of co-lead this organization in a way that you're always in sync?
I'm going to turn to the boss.
You answered my question.
You know, I know who I work for.
I think, I mean, we have the benefit of having worked together, you know, very, I mean, that's where we met at Microsoft, and I don't know if folks know that we are the first couple to meet and get married at Microsoft. So we have a,
hey.
We have a.
Isn't that nice?
Yes.
We hired some, well, anyway.
So he, I was overseeing marketing communications, and Jeff was sort of the first business leader in product marketing. And so it was, you know, there was that collaborative spirit early on. So I guess part mm-hmm. of part of that, I think, allowed for sort of no mystery, no surprises when, you know, later on we came together in our philanthropy. We have been really lucky, I think, again, because much of our work has been inspired by our personal experiences as parents, our commitment to community, mm-hmm. And really undergirded by the discipline of really wanting to work at the systems level, really identifying gaps where others are not funding. There's a lot of important issues out there, but mm-hmm. we have been really kind of charged ourselves with finding those issues that really need attention and others are not funding in that area. And probably the most important element is that we are very committed to addressing issues for underserved and low-income populations. So our organization, it's a learning curve for us, but we're very committed to diversity, equity, and inclusion and really understanding the young populations that do not have equitable access to quality education or quality expanded mm-hmm. learning opportunities, or you know, in the case of homelessness, you know, a stable place to sleep. Yeah. And so, we've been really lucky, I think, in terms of being aligned because of those foundational principles that we both agree on. Gosh, where have we had some disagreements? We got to think of some good things.
I think, yeah. You know, part of why it works so well is we are partners in life. Yeah. You know, the way in which we think about how we support our kids, you know, our various business entities, et cetera. I mean, we're kind of like Charlie and Warren, don't you think?
But better looking.
So, you know, so that helps. But we also have different styles. And I think I'm very... I think I'm pretty self-aware of some of the weaknesses I have. And I will have a tendency to say, oh, why don't we do this? Or, oh, why don't we do that? And Tricia is really good at basically saying, well, why? You know, and really kind of teasing out how does that fit? And, you know, because I can get passionate about a lot of things really quickly. That is one of the characteristics mm-hmm. of my personality. And that is not necessarily a formula for success in philanthropy. Bill and Melinda preach how important it is to have a focus. Now, I will say that it may be an oxymoron to focus on 28 strategies at the Gates Foundation. And I tried to put in a discipline to help them on that. But for us, I think it's important to have focus. And I think Tricia does a really good job of trying to help shape my enthusiasm for maybe too many different things. So, you know, I don't think there's been anything that we've done or funded where we had some big disagreement. You and I had some good back and forth on the College Success Foundation at one point in time, but I'd help the work be better. Right. And so that's good.
And I think a part of where, if we are not clear, there's an emerging area that we're early in around opportunity youth, which is sort of the bigger tent, youth homelessness, which is a smaller subset of that. But I think for Jeff and I, we will just continue to gather data and information and challenge our staff until we feel like we're comfortable and clear on where we can actually make a difference. And I think just my comment on working with Jeff, he brings sort of a brilliant set of analytics and really crisp, clear sort of frameworks to our work. It's one thing to be...
I'm kind of her data man.
It's one thing to be passionate about an issue. It's another to really approach it in a very measured way. And I think that that's been fantastic for our work at the Raikes Foundation. And Jeff has really imbued that discipline and really been very, has stewarded it along the way as we've grown.
Thank you, honey. Can I have my performance review next week?
Gonna, yeah. So before we wrap up, Jeff, maybe you can talk a little bit about...
I wanted to say a little bit more about the work with Nadia and also to introduce Stephanie Gillis, who's leading the Impact Driven Philanthropy Initiative for the Raikes Foundation, and Molly Watkins, who's here as she's our Director of Communications. We are very passionate about the work we're doing, youth homelessness, expanded learning, learning mindsets and skills. As you can tell, we're also very passionate about the how. How do we do philanthropy better? How do we help others do philanthropy better? So an outgrowth of this work with Stanford PACS and other partners is what we call the Giving Compass. We now have two startups underway. And what the Giving Compass is it's really building the broad community of philanthropists who want to raise their game in impact and get them connected with each other, get them connected with the resources, get them connected with the content and the tools. It in part comes out of some of the research with Nadia that we discovered that philanthropists are very interested in having access to high quality, curated, objective content, tools, and other types of resources, peers, et cetera. So the Giving Compass is really about the community, the broad community, which we hope will be national and then international, and then the resources to support them. The parallel startup is called Giving Tech. We actually think one of the ways to facilitate this, and of course we're software people, so of course software is like the hammer and the rest of the world's the nail. And Giving Tech is the underlying technology platform to support that. And so that'll be a way for people to get to those resources, get to their peers, get to the experts, et cetera. And so we have those two startups underway. We'll launch later this year, but I wanted, Tricia and I wanted you to know that we're really carrying this forward because we think this is a great opportunity and we hope that as part of the research or other work that you'll want to get connected with us. We have the four I's. We're trying to involve the infrastructure that supports philanthropy. We're investing in those champions that are trying to educate donors. We're trying to make sure that people, the broad community, is inspired to raise their impact. And we're trying to be innovative with things like, both the Giving Tech platform, but also tools that can really help people in their journey. So that's what we're trying to do to carry this forward. And we just really appreciate the opportunity to be with you here today.
So one of the things I asked earlier was, how are you helping other donors kind of think through their... You guys exemplified that today, and I can't thank you enough for joining us today and sharing your insights and it sounds as though there's going to be a lot of collaboration in the future on a lot of different things. Hope the Mariners and the Dodgers are in the World
Series.
That'd
be great.
I hope the Cardinal and the Trojans are in the Pac-12 championship.
That'd be fine.
So, but thank you very much for your collaboration.
Thank you.
It's been amazing.
Thank you.
So, thank you.